I'm Dave.
And I'm Mackenzie. We're here today to help you build the KitBot. Before we jump into actually building the KitBot, we want to take a moment to talk about what the KitBot is and what it's capable of.
The KitBot for a 2025 game is capable of the following actions. Drive around the field using a differential drivetrain, also commonly referred to as tank, geared for a top achievable speed of 15 feet per second. The KitBot does not fit under the deeper shell cages, but can maneuver between the cages or push them out of the way while driving through. Preload a coral for use in auto, score leaf points, score coral in L1 of the reef, collect coral from the coral station, and play defense.
Looks like a great starter robot for teams. Let's jump into showing teams how to build it.
Great idea. First, we want to note that while the KitBot superstructure could be integrated with a variety of drivetrain shapes and types, it is designed to most easily integrate with AM14U6 chassis constructed in the long orientation, and that's what we're going to be doing today.
First, we're going to grab the materials that are provided in the black tote. Shout out to all the suppliers who help provide items to our teams.
Some sheet metal plates from Senkutsen, a 3D printed radio mount from Stratasys, and some spacers from the ThriftyBot.
Reclosable fastener from 3M.
Some grip tape and a SIM motor from Andymark.
Squishy wheels from ThriftyBot.
Some half-inch hex, some shaft collars, some bearings, and an adapter from Rev Robotics.
The RSL from Rockwell.
The screws for the SIM motor are in the blue bag.
And printed pulleys from Form Labs.
Some belts, a hardware kit, and some 3D printed adapters from West Coast Products. Next, you need to gather all the additional materials. We have done this already, as you can see here.
It's worth noting that in today's build, we're using the materials provided and recommended in the kit. But first, it suggested alternative items in the instructions that teams could use instead.
Before we jump in, we also want to note that First has provided two options for how to build bumpers detailed in the instructions. We won't be showing those steps in this video, but if you're planning to follow these steps, be sure to get the additional materials needed.
Great, so now let's move on to the KitBot manufacturing. The first step is to cut our 1-inch square tubing according to the cut list first provided. Let's head over to the shop. As a reminder, when using tools in the shop, you should use proper safety practices like using safety glasses, having closed-toed shoes, and tie back any loose hair or jewelry. We'll start with cutting the crossbeam to 16 inches. To do this, you want to take your tape measure and measure to 16 inches and put a mark. Remember that if you're using a Sharpie, it generally draws thick lines. So make sure to align one edge of the wide line with the desired measurement, not the center. And once you have it marked, you can cut it. We're going to use a hacksaw, but teams can choose to cut this with other saws they may have on hand. When using a hacksaw, be sure to keep the hacksaw straight. Next, you will continue on and do this for the remaining items in the cut list until you have them all done. Fantastic. Next is to pre-drill all the holes in the piece of the tube we just cut. We're going to start with the crossbeam and use the attached drawing to measure and mark the 6 holes. To do this, you want to measure each one with a tape measure. We will start with 15.5 inches and put a mark. Remember that if you are using a Sharpie, it generally draws thick lines. So make sure to align one edge of the wide line with the desired measurement, not the center. Then use a tape measure to find the center of the tube and use a punch to mark the hole. Repeat that with all holes on the piece, then drill all these out with a 0.201 inch drill bit. Be sure to keep the drill straight to keep the holes lined up, as we'll be putting bolts through these later. Then we'll repeat this same process with the front vertical posts, diagonal rails, and back vertical posts. Next up is to cut a few panels out of the 0.118 polycarbonate, starting with the track side. The best way to cut out this piece is to use a tape measure to measure and mark the outside dimensions, which are 20¾ inches by 6 inches. You can use your pre-cut aluminum tube to make a straight line. First also notes that we should pre-drill 7 holes with a 0.201 inch drill bit. To do this, measure each hole and use a punch to mark the center of the hole. Then we will use the drill to drill them out. Then we will repeat this process with the track floor, track roof, front guard panel, and back guard panel, and drill any holes noted in the drawings. There is an optional step in the instructions to cut spacers out of PVC, We will not be showing that today as we have 3D printed spacers. Be sure to follow the instructions if you need those parts. Now that we have everything prepared, we can begin to build. We'll note that the top frame, back frame, and front frame may be assembled in parallel before they are combined into a single assembly. We will show them one at a time for ease. We're going to head back to the build space to do our assembly.
Let's start with the top frame. To build this, we're going to use a bunch of items that we just prepared and a few items from our kit. The first step is to insert the hex bearings into the two roller blades. We're going to do this with a rubber mallet, but teams can also use an arbor press or table vise if preferred. The flange of the bearing should be on the same side as the engraved text on both plates. Make sure to support the plate as close to the bearing holes as possible to avoid bending the plate. Next, we are going to insert the 3D printed hex shaft adapters into the end of each pulley, again using a rubber mallet. It is very important to make sure the two hex adapters are aligned to each other in the pulley so that the hex shaft can slide through both of them. Then we attach the SIM motor to the roller plate that has KitBot 2025 engraved. The motor body should be on the opposite side of the engraved text, and we'll attach it with the 1/2-inch long 1032 socket head cap screws. Now that we have the motor attached, place the machine key into the keyway on the shaft, then slide the 8mm to 1/2-inch hex adapter onto the shaft. Note to align the keyway over the recently installed machine key. Then slide the 1/8-inch long hex spacer, 24-tooth pulley, and the push-on retaining ring onto the shaft in that order. Next, take one of the diagonal rails and identify the end that has 7 holes drilled into it. Take the roller plate with the motor attached to it and bolt it to the diagonal rail such that the motor body and tube are on the same side of the plate. We will put a 1.5-inch long 1032 button head cap screw through the 1st, 3rd, and 6th holes. Now that we have everything lined up, we will add lock nuts and tighten. It is important not to over-tighten these as it could crush the tube. Now we repeat the last step with the other plate and diagonal tube. The tube should be on the opposite side of the engraved text. Okay, so now we have 2 assemblies and we're going to attach them together with the track floor. To do this, place the box tube assemblies spaced apart roughly the distance of the track floor. Then we will put the track floor on top, line up the holes, and attach the items together with the 12 1.5-inch long 1032 button head cap screws. Make sure the bolt heads are on the plastic side, and then we'll add lock nuts and tighten. Now we have 1 assembly and are going to do a few more things to complete it. Next, we are going to attach the track sides. Take one of the track sides and line it up with the 3 pre-drilled holes and attach it with 3 1.5-inch long 1032 button head cap screws and 1032 lock nuts. We'll do that again, attaching the other side as well. Next, we'll attach the track roof by placing it on the top sides of the track sides and securing it with zip ties. Make sure you keep the heads of the cable ties on the outside of the structure and then use flush cutters to cut off the excess after pulling them tight. Next, we're going to attach the roller mechanism by taking the roller shaft and sliding it through one of the bearings, then adding the following items in order. 2 and 3/8-inch long hex spacer, a 4-inch compliant wheel, 2-inch long hex spacer, a 4-inch compliant wheel, 2-inch long hex spacer, 4-inch compliant wheel, 2-inch long hex spacer, 4-inch compliant wheel, 2-inch long hex spacer, 4-inch compliant wheel, and a 2 and 3/8-inch long hex spacer. Then push the shaft through the second bearing so that it sticks out on both sides of the assembly. If it is challenging to push the shaft through the second bearing, loosen up the bolts holding the rest of the assembly together and retighten it once it is in a position where the shaft can move freely. On the same side of the assembly with the pulley, we are going to add an 1/8-inch hex spacer, then slide the larger pulley with the 1/32 HTD belt, wrapping the belt around both of the pulleys so that they are connected. Next, we push the roller shaft so that the extra is approximately even on both sides. Slide on the hex shaft collars and tighten them so that everything is locked into place. The last step of the top frame is to cut 4 16-inch long strips of gaffer's tape and stick them in a row at the end of the track floor, leaving no gaps. These pieces of tape are meant to add friction between the game piece and the track floor, and therefore this tape may need to be replaced throughout the season to ensure an ample amount of friction. If you notice your coral spinning in place, you know it may be time to clean or replace the tape. Now we have a top frame.
The back frame requires T-brackets, the RSL mount, back vertical posts, the cross beam, radio mount, and some hardware. First, we are going to attach the back vertical posts and cross beams with the T-brackets. To do that, we're going to lay out the back two vertical posts so the posts match direction, with matching holes on top and bottom and the 5 holes in about the middle of the piece face up. Then we'll place the cross beam in the middle of the two pieces and use the T-bracket and bolts to attach everything together on each side. If the holes are not quite lining up, start with one side, ensuring the T-bracket stays square with the post, and drill out the holes as needed to secure. With the T-brackets facing away from you and the back vertical posts oriented with a single pair of holes at the bottom, locate the 4th and 5th hole down on the outside of the right post. Use 2 1.5-inch long 1032 button head cap screws and 1032 lock nuts to attach the RSL mount so the large hole in the RSL mount is toward you on the opposite side of the tube compared to the T-brackets. On the top of the other back vertical post, we will attach the 3D printed radio mounts to the 6th and 8th holes, sandwiching the tube in between the two pieces. And attach with 2 1¾-inch long 1032 socket head cap screws and 1032 lock nuts. The large flat sides of the radio mount should both face away from the T-brackets. And now we're done with building the back frame. Now we're going to build the front frame. To do this, we will need some T-brackets, the front vertical posts, a crossbeam, and some hardware. First, we are going to attach the front vertical posts and crossbeam with the T-brackets. To do that, we're going to lay out the two front vertical posts so the posts match direction with matching holes on top and bottom, and the 5 holes in about the middle of the piece face up. Then we'll place the crossbeam in the middle of the two pieces and use the T-brackets and bolts to attach everything together on each side. If the holes are not quite lining up, start with one side, ensuring the T-bracket stays square with the post, and drill out holes as needed to secure. And that's it for the front frame. Now we can attach this to our drive base.
For this step, we need the front frame, the back frame, the AM1 for your drive, and some hardware. It's important to note that if you're using an older model of the drive base kit, the length of the front and back rails will likely need to be modified, and there will be some holes that will need to be drilled in the side rails to make sure that everything aligns correctly. We have the AM1 for U6, so we're going to use that today. Start with the front frame and make sure the T-brackets are facing outside of the robot. Place it into the drive base so that the bottom of the tubes are below the top of the rails. Once it's in place, use 2 1.5-inch long 1032 button head cap screws and 1032 lock nuts to attach it to the frame. Be sure to have the bowl heads facing the inside of the robot. If you are struggling to fit a wrench in or get the lock nut into place while tightening, we recommend using a small piece of tape, place it on the back side of the wrench, and then place the nut into the pocket formed by the tape. This allows you to use the wrench to carry the nut into the correct spot to get it started. Then we'll attach the back frame in a similar way. Great, now that we've got the front and back frames in, we can attach the top frame to the robot. To do that, we'll need the robot through the last step, the top frame, the back angle plate, and some hardware. Take the top frame and line up the remaining holes on the roller plates to the front frame and attach with 2 1.5-inch long 1032 button head cap screws and 1032 lock nuts on each side. you want to make sure to not fully tighten these yet, as it makes it easier to line up these next few bolts. Next, use the back angle plates and sandwich them around the top frame and the back frame, and attach with 1.5-inch long 1032 button head cap screws and 1032 lock nuts. Now that all these bolts are attached, tighten these as well as the bolts from the previous step.
We're super close. In the final step, we will add the radio, RSL, and some protective panels. To do that, we'll need the robot through the last step, the front guard panel, the back guard panel, some reclosable fastener, the VH-109 radio, the RSL light, and two cable ties. First, we are going to take the VH-109 radio and attach it to the 3D printed radio mounts with two 50-pound cable ties wrapping around the vertical box tube, ensuring the power connection is facing down. Tighten the cable ties and then cut off the excess. Next, we are going to get the RSL set up. To do that, remove the plastic nut from the RSL. Then, insert the RSL into the RSL mount plate, and then use the plastic nut to attach it in place. Next, attach the protective panels. We will start with the front guard panel. To do that, we'll cut 4 2-inch pieces of reclosable fastener. Then peel the backing from one side of the matching pieces, exposing the adhesive, and stick the reclosable fastener onto the panel. We are going to stick one piece in approximately each corner. Make sure to pay attention to where this will line up on the robot. The fastener won't stick as well if it overlaps the T-brackets. Then, remove the backing from the other side of the reclosable fasteners and carefully position the guard panel onto the aluminum tubes and press it into place. It is important to press firmly and give the adhesive some time to adhere before removing the panels. Finally, repeat those steps and place the reclosable fastener on the back guard panel to attach that in place. Yeah.
Wow, that was fun.
Once you get to this step, you'll want to build the electronics board, wire it all, mount a battery, and build and attach your bumpers.
In this year, there are step-by-step instructions on how to build bumpers specifically for the Kitbot. So if you need help, check out section 7 of the Kitbot instructions.
And there are new, easier to follow instructions on how to wire up your electronics too.
And once you do all of that, it'll look like this.
As a reminder, teams, the Kitbot was designed to keep things very simple, which means there may be opportunities to iterate and improve on the existing capabilities it has. With this in mind, teams may choose to add additional components to allow the robot to pick game pieces up off the ground, score algae, climb on the cages, and more. Teams can reference the Kitbot enhancement/iteration guide for a process to explore these improvements.
Great, should we go practice with this?